Fervent. Friends, let not be your motto. It could be a disaster. You must know the difference between afferent and efferent. And I told you that day, I was deliberately saying efferent and afferent. Did I not say that? So that you would always remember that you thought I was only kidding. Right? So when the information travels along the efferent, where would that information go to? Yes? The effector. And then what happens in the effector? There is a response. Now you would understand why I'm doing all these very soon. This afternoon, we're going to look at the performance of the peripheral nervous system. The nervous system, as we know it, is made up of two major parts. The central nervous system, the CNS, is made up of the brain and the spinal cord. And the peripheral nervous system is made up of, you go and find that out. It is the peripheral nervous system that we're going to be working on in these series of labs. Now, what are we interested in? The nervous system can be further broken down into the sensory limb and the motor limb. If you look at the homeostatic control system, you can identify the motor system and the sensory system. What is the motor system? Or let's put it the other way around. What is the sensory system? Yes?
All the sense organs.
All right. What would the sense organs do? Yes?
Sense organs will be able to pick up stimulus.
Yes.
That they are receptive to.
That's right. So that is the sensory system collecting information from the environment. The sensory system is responsible for gathering information and feeding this information to the integrating center. Are we together? Now, when the integrating center has done its work and has synthesized a response, we have said that it transmits this response along the efferent to the effector. So what would this part of the nervous system be referred to? You've got, yes? The motor system. This is the motor system. The motor system is made up of the effector or effectors. All right? How do we check for the integrity of the motor system in a patient?
In order for me to assess the integrity of the motor system, there will be different components that I will be interested in. For example, the tone of that motor system, for example, if we are dealing with muscles, the strength of it, So then you have to, you can't analyze it as to one, but there will be different aspects of it that enable it to function as a whole and as one system. So you take a look at every single individual.
You drive, don't you?
Yes. Yes.
The way you. What you have said and what these gentlemen have said are correct, part and parcel of what we are interested in. But to assess the integrity of the motor system, the first thing that you need to find out from the individual, your patient, is the history. They will tell you something. And I told you, we are now putting ourselves in the clinical realm. It may not be what will be required of you now, but I didn't want to skip that. You always need to talk to the patient and find out from the patient what the situation is from their own perspective. The patient is going to tell you, I feel this, I feel that, and that, and that, and that. And it has been going on for how many months, or how many days, or how many hours. All right? So you need a fairly good history. You have not been trained to do that yet. All right? But just keep it at the back of your mind. Now, in clinical practice, when we have taken the history, the next thing we do is to do a physical examination. Do a physical examination. Now, what does this entail? Has anybody got an idea? Yes, Joanna. Thank you.
Their
yes.
Posture, maybe if they've got tremors, external examination, what could be wrong with the patient when they're speaking?
You take a good look at the individual. All right? That is the very first thing you do in examination. And we call that inspection. You do a thorough inspection. And when we talk about inspection, we're not talking about the inspection that is done by the police. Is it that the bone is broken that you can see? Is it that there's no muscle there so he cannot raise his arm? What is it that is wrong with the arm or with the shoulder that is making it difficult for this person to raise the arm? All right? So you do a good inspection. Then you go on to palpation. That is, after the inspection, you now want to touch and find out what is going on around. And if, as we are doing, you want to have an idea about muscles, you want to find out whether these muscles are really functioning. Is there any tone in the muscle? Or the muscle is just flaccid? Is there a muscle at all? What is the nature of the muscle? Is it wasted? Wasted is atrophy. Is there atrophy? Or is there hypertrophy? What is the state of affairs? You do this by palpation. And then the next thing is to percuss. You percuss. You hit with your fingers. You make music. It is not in all systems. In this particular system, it may not be useful. And finally, you do what is called auscultation. We're talking about IPPA, muscle strength refers to the amount of force that a muscle can produce with a single
contraction.
With a single maximal effort. It must be maximal effort. It's not over
time.
Over time. And we're going to use an instrument called the hand grip dynamometer. You don't pay attention. Homeostasis is very important for the survival of the organism. Once we lose out on homeostasis, or once homeostasis fails us, then we get to what you said, death. All right? Now let us jump very quickly. I'm tempted to move.
I'll try to follow you, bro.
What is homeostasis? Speak up. This is the only time you will know your strengths, and nobody is going to send you out. You don't lose face, you don't do anything. If you are handsome, you will continue to be handsome. If you are ugly, you might probably become prettier. All right? Do we ever keep a constant environment?
Internal environment.
Do we ever keep constant internal environment? Yes, what's your name?
I'm Tenaya. Homeostasis is the maintenance of, it's the body's maintenance of the body system within a normal range. So it's a dynamic state whereby the body tries to maintain its factors within a normal range.
Right? I'm glad you talk about the range. For as long as you talk about range, you are making sense. All right? Homeostasis is a process. And what is process or processes that are employed to enable the body to keep a reasonably constant internal environment? All right? Reasonably constant. Which means then that there is going to operate within a range. For as long as you are within the range, you are normal. If you go out of the range, then something is going wrong, and the body will have to respond appropriately. All right, let us jump again. Now we know what homeostasis is. There are two major communication systems in the body. All right? Do you agree? There are two major communication systems. If you don't agree, I want you to come up with an alternative. But I'm saying there are two major communication systems. You agree? All right, now that you agree, what are these systems?
This is one of them is the sensory system, whereby the body recognizes some of the sensors that are.
That is true.
And then it starts sending some sensors that the body follows something different.
Did you understand my question? I asked about the two communication systems in the body. gentleman, yes, you. What's your name?
Mario. The endocrine system, communication system, and the neural system.
Are you sure?
100%.
Very good. You are right. The two communication systems are, Rebecca, the endocrine system and the nervous system. Okay? Right. Of the endocrine system. Today we are starting our journey into the nervous system, the role of the nervous system, and the role of the nervous system in homeostasis. All right? Now, let's get back to homeostasis. What are the components of the homeostatic control system? It's a system, isn't that so? What are the components?
The homeostatic control mechanism system should have a sensor, an integrating center, and a response mechanism or an effector.
Would anybody want to add anything to it? Thank you very much. Yes. Lady, what's your name?
Rooster.
Rooster?
Yes.
Yes, Rooster is here. Rooster Kalomo. All right.
It includes an efferent and an efferent pathway.
Yes, you have added to those. Now you know there is one important component that is still missing. Yes, lady here. What's your name?
Jean Mary.
Yes, Jean Mary.
All right. Outside system, yes.
What you say must be correct.
Okay, stimulus or stimulus.
Stimulus. That is extremely important. That is the very first component. Please don't forget. You have the stimulus. The stimulus would obviously stimulate the receptor. And you know what happens in the receptor, don't you? There is transduction of energy in the receptor to generate an electrical event, which is then transmitted along the afferent pathway. Most of the time, to the integrating center. Some of the time, it does not get to the integrating center. What happens in the integrating center? There's a famous song that I taught you. What happens in the integrating center? Am I talking to the wrong class?
No.
Have I ever taught you?
Yes.
Yes, so it's because there was so much diffidence in their faces. I thought this was the one that I taught. Yes? Tell us, what's your name?
Florence.
Florence Nightingale. Your name is not here. Probably, Florence Imata. All right. You even know where they appear on the list. Yes, Florence.
What happens in the integration center?
Yes.
It brings about response.
That is true. That is true. But what happens there? It's good to know what it does. But how does it come to do that? Yes, my dear. The smile is good, but the answer will be better.
Yes.
Moses, I'll come to you very soon. What's your name?
My name is Rauha.
What?
Rauha.
Rauha. Yes. All right. I can. It's probably somewhere here. Yes, Rahab, go ahead.
In the integrating center, the information is relayed and it goes.
I don't think Mario, Moses hears you.
The information is relayed to. The information is relayed to the spinal cord and the central nervous system, and through synapses and then goes to the effectors.
And you are telling me the stations. You are not saying exactly what happens. Lara Bea. Who is Lara? Oh, yes, Lara.
So can you repeat the question? Because I don't really understand the question.
Just answer it the way you understood it. You know, in our days, there used to be oral examination, and
the integrating center usually interprets the stimulus that comes along.
It does. That is one part. The integrating center will collect all information from all the stimuli all over, and then there will be collation of the information, and then there will be analysis of the information, and after the analysis of the information, the integrating center would then synthesize an appropriate response. This is what muscle strength is, and that is exactly what you are going to test. All right? When you have checked muscle strength, you would go on, you would check muscle strength using an equipment called the hand grip dynamometer. A very long name. I think it's somewhere along there. Do they have it over there too?
Yeah.
Yes. Any alpha? What is a reflex? It is an involuntary, unconscious response to a stimulus. Okay? We will be checking that out. And the important thing here is to be able to trace the pathways. We have just gone with reflexes. There are two types of reflexes. We have superficial reflexes and deep reflexes. And if you are prepared, you will know the difference between superficial reflexes, because it's there, and deep reflexes. The instructions